I'm clearly visible, audible. Let me confirm in few seconds. If I'm clearly visible, I will start the lecture ahead. Just give me few seconds to confirm whether it is properly visible and audible or not. Okay. So I guess I am clearly visible and audible to you people. So I welcome you all for this session. I'm Dr. Priyanka Sachdev here, and today I'm here to continue my antimicrobial series. So this is a video on antimicrobial drugs. In antimicrobial drugs, till now, we have already completed the drugs which inhibit nucleic acid synthesis, either directly or indirectly, that is sulfonamides, trimethoprim and quinolones. We have already completed it. These are the three drugs which inhibit nucleic acid synthesis, either DNA or RNA, either directly or indirectly. Then we have completed the drugs which inhibit protein synthesis inhibitors. That is tetracycline, chloramphenicol, aminoglycoside and erythromycin. In all these drugs, I have asked you to make these comparative table in which I have given you numerous mnemonics of the adverse effects and uses. You know the full form of all of them. Those who are my old student, they know the full form. Just a second, give me a, yeah, okay, just a second, okay. Okay, so and after that, we have seen all these mnemonics and side effects. After that, we have completed beta lactams, that is penicillin, cephalosporins, carbapenem, monobactam. Then we have started antitubercular drugs. In the last lecture, we have already covered the primary, these antitubercular drugs, the five first line drugs, that is H, R, Z, E, and S. We have already completed these five drugs. Today, I have to teach you DOTS. That is directly observed therapy short treatment. How, at what doses, how, what is the combination of these drugs in category 1 patient and category 2 patient, that I am going to teach you today. So before starting to DOTS, I asked you to make this comparative table between HRZES. So we have already done this comparison, that is isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, ethambutol and streptomycin. Under what headings we have done this comparison? The introduction, in which we have told which drug among them is bactericidal or which is bacteriostatic. So only ethambutol is bacteriostatic. Rest all are bactericidal. They kill the bacteria. Rest all of them are bactericidal. What is the mechanism of action of each of them? To understand the mechanism of action of each of them, I have explained you this diagram. In the last lecture only, we have discussed it. What we have discussed? What is the mycobacterial cell wall? It is made up of two things, mycolic acid and arabinogalactan. So let me draw a bacteria for you. So this is a mycobacteria. This is the nucleus of the mycobacteria. This is the DNA. This is the nucleus. This is the cell membrane. Above the cell membrane, this is the cell wall. Cell wall is made up of two things. That is mycolic acid, number one, and arabinogalactan, number two. So for the formation of this cell wall, we have to synthesize two things. The bacteria has to synthesize two things, mycolic acid and arabinogalactan. How mycolic acid and arabinogalactan are formed? They are formed from their raw materials using three enzymes. So mycolic acid is formed from acetyl CoA. It will get converted into fatty acid chain. It will get converted into mycolic acid. For this, two enzymes are required, FAS1 and FAS2. In the similar way, galactose and arabinose combine together to form arabinogalactan, and for this another enzyme is required. The name of the enzyme is arabinotransferase. So what is the mechanism of action of these drugs? I was telling you, what is the mechanism of action of these drugs? So these drugs, from five drugs, three of them are inhibiting bacterial cell wall synthesis. So which three of them? So the first drug which inhibit bacterial cell wall synthesis is isoniazid, H, isoniazid, R nahi, H ka R ke baad Z. Z is inhibiting again FAS2. Isoniazid was inhibiting FAS2. Pyrazinamide is inhibiting FAS1. So isoniazid and pyrazinamide, both of them are inhibiting mycolic acid synthesis by inhibiting various enzymes for mycolic acid. So ultimately, mycobacterial cell wall is not formed. HRZE, ethambutol, is inhibiting arabinoside transferase. So arabinogalactan is not formed. Ultimately, these three drugs, HZE, that is isoniazid, pyrazinamide and ethambutol, these three drugs are inhibiting bacterial cell wall synthesis by inhibiting various things in this bacterial cell wall, either mycolic acid or arabinogalactan. Have you got it? That is the thing. So out of the five, the three mechanism of action is clear to you. All of them are bactericidal. Only one is bacteriostatic, that is ethambutol, that you have to learn. mechanism of action that you have to learn. H is inhibiting FAS2, Z is inhibiting FAS1, and E is inhibiting arabinosyl galactose. So these three are inhibiting bacterial cell wall. What about R and S? R inhibit bacterial RNA synthesis by inhibiting an enzyme, DNA dependent RNA polymerase. This is the name of the enzyme which is inhibited by rifampicin. So RNA is not synthesized. Since RNA is not synthesized, so bacteria will die. And S inhibit protein synthesis in the bacteria by combining to 30S, 50S. I'm sorry, at the junction of 30 and 50S ribosome. I'm sorry, just give me a 1 minute. So 30S, 50S and the junction of 30 and 50S, so it inhibits protein synthesis. So that is the mechanism of action of each of them. Pharmacokinetics, I told you various important points in the pharmacokinetics, and about adverse effects also, I've told you various important adverse effects that I would like to revise you before coming on dots. So in isoniazid, the most important adverse effect in the first three drugs was hepatitis. Hepatitis is the side effect of isoniazid, rifampicin and pyrazinamide, all of them. There is one more side effect, that is hyperuricemia, that is gout. That is a side effect of pyrazinamide and ethambutol. So that is common for these two drugs, that is hyperuricemia or gout. There are some peculiar side effects which are not the carryover in each other. So isoniazid has a peculiar side effect, that is neuropathy, peripheral neuropathy. Due to the deficiency of pyridoxine, you know. So peripheral neuropathy is an important side effect here. Rifampicin, it is flu-like syndrome, nothing special, and orange color urine. The urine will become orange color. All secretions become orange color. Z may there is nothing more important. Ethambutol may it is optic neuritis or color blindness. And streptomycin may the mnemonic was on. That is autotoxicity, neurotoxicity, nephrotoxicity. That was the mnemonic. So these were the adverse effects that we have already covered. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up if you got it. Now I am moving on dots. How we combine the five drugs. If you know it, I will move directly on the dots. So isoniazid we have already covered. Yeah, this table is also important. From that, you know which among them is static. Only ethambutol is static. Rest all of them are sidal, as I have told you. Only ethambutol is static. Hepatotoxic are the first three drugs causing hepatitis. Usme bhi the most important is pyrazinamide. So pyrazinamide followed by rifampicin followed by isoniazid. That is the sequence. And last two drugs, E and S, are not causing hepatitis. Which bacteria are inhibited by them? Extracellular or intracellular or both? So isoniazid and rifampicin inhibit extracellular as well as intracellular. Pyrazinamide inhibit only intracellular. Streptomycin inhibit only extracellular. And ethambutol again inhibit both extra and intra. That is the thing. Have you got it? So coming on dots. I'm directly coming on the dots. This portion is already covered in the last video. So I'm coming on the combination of the drugs, how we combine the five drugs. Just give me 1 minute, let me move directly on the dots. Okay, I'm skipping the polls also. I will launch the polls in the end, the combined polls. So I'm coming on dots. Okay, so how we manage tuberculosis. I hope it is visible to you, the PPT is visible to you. Management of tuberculosis is by dots. What is the full form of the dots? It is directly observed therapy short treatment, DOTS, dots. It comes under RNTCP. You know what is RNTCP? Revised National Tuberculosis Control Program in the India. That is RNTCP. So under RNTCP, there is DOTS. Why DOTS is known as DOTS? I mean, why it is known as directly observed? So because under DOTS, under RNTCP program, we offer the treatment of the TB free of cost to the patient in the form of the DOTS. So any patient who is diagnosed case of tuberculosis, the government will offer free treatment of the tuberculosis under a program known as DOTS. But there is some condition for providing free treatment. Free treatment is provided in all government hospitals, government setups, at all PSCs, but under wherever RNTCP is applicable. So we will provide this free treatment free of cost, but there is a condition that should be directly observed. What do you mean by directly observed? That is the logo for DOTS. Sure cure for TB. You can see, you have to identify it. If it comes in your exam, you have to identify it as a logo for DOTS that you have to learn. Now in DOTS, a healthcare provider can be a trained person, it can be Asha, it can be Anganwadi worker, it can be any nurse, it can be any, you know, any healthcare provider. It can watch it. The patient is swallowing the medicine in front of him. Can you see the part? He is watching, the patient is taking the medicine in front of him. That is directly observed. That's why it is known as directly observed short therapy. And it is short as compared to previous treatment, it is short. So that's why it is known as directly observed treatment short course. So that is DOTS. That is a full form of DOTS. Here a trained person watches the patient is swallowing the medicine in intensive phase. That is the thing. Now medicine comes in the form of the strips. There are two phases in therapy, intensive phase and continuation phase. In intensive phase, all the doses are seen under direct supervision. All the doses. So patient have to come to the hospital daily in front of a healthcare provider. The healthcare provider will provide the tablets to the patient. So one tablet, whatever tablet. So patient will take the tablet in front of the healthcare provider in intensive phase daily. All doses have to be given in front of healthcare provider. So that is intensive phase. After intensive phase, there is continuation phase. In continuation phase, just suppose Monday to Saturday, we provide the therapy daily. So every Monday, patient has to come to the hospital. So first dose has to be taken in front of healthcare provider, that is Monday wala dose. After that, rest of the doses from Tuesday to Saturday, we will provide the strip for home. We will provide the strip to the patient for home for the next 6 days. Not for always, only for next 6 days, we will give the tablet. We will give that strip for the next week, for that running week. So patient has to take the tablet at the home, don't have to come hospital daily. The next Monday patient will come again with an empty strip. When the patient will provide the empty strip, then we will provide the new strip. So that is a rule. Have you got it? That is a rule. So in continuation phase, at least first dose of every week is directly observed. Rest of the doses are not observed. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up if you got it. Have you got it? So that is the thing. Now, if any patient, you are a doctor, if any patient is coming in front of you and he is having cough since last few weeks and cough is not responding to antibiotics. So and patient is having low grade fever also every evening. Patient is having weight loss also. Patient is having lymphadenopathy also. So your first suspicion will be patient is having tuberculosis. So what you will do, patient is having cough with fever with weight loss. So this is a typical clinical scenario of tuberculosis. Such patient is coming to your clinic. So you will ask the patient to do a sputum microscopy. So 3 sputum microscopies are done. First, you will give the container, sterile container to the patient and ask to provide the sputum on spot. So first test is always on spot. First specimen is always on spot. And you will ask the patient to submit it in the laboratory. Number one, you will provide 2 empty containers to the patient for home and ask to give the sputum the second day and third day, the first morning sputum. The next day patient when waking up. So after that patient has to cough and give the sputum. So first morning sample, that is not spot, that is second day morning sample and third day morning sample. So all of them has to be provided to the laboratory. Out of these 3 specimen, if out of these 3 at least one is positive, we will start DOTS. We will straightforward start DOTS. If none of them is positive, we will look for some other treatment. If one is positive, 2 is positive, or all 3 are positive, we will start the treatment as DOTS. Have you got it? That is the thing. Now whenever, if any one out of the 3 sputum is coming positive, we have to decide whether the patient is category 1 or category 2. There are 2 categories of the patient. Category 1 treatment is different. Category 2 treatment is different. What is the difference between cat 1 and cat 2? What is the difference? Cat 1 is a new patient. He has never taken DOTS before. None of the drugs of the DOTS, that is HRZDS, the 5 drugs are taken before. He is taking the drugs for the first time. He is a new patient. So you have to take the history. Whether you have taken this treatment before any time in your life, whether few weeks back, whether few years back, whether in your childhood, any time. If you have taken DOTS, you are not cat 1. Cat 1 is a new patient. Always a new patient who has never taken DOTS till now in his or her life. That is cat 1. Cat 2 is previously treated patient. Now cat 2 are of 3 types. What do you mean by cat 2? Cat 2 is cat 1. What are cat 1? Cat 1 are the new patient. These are smear positive. Out of the 3 smear, at least one is positive. Smear positive new TB patient. New one. Who have not taken anti-TB drugs in the past. till now, till their life, they have not taken. These are cat one, category one. And category two are previously treated. Now they are of three types. Either they are the defaulter. What do you mean by defaulter? Or they are relapse, or they are failure. All of them have taken dots previously. What do you mean by defaulter? Defaulter is a patient who has taken treatment for few days, then left the treatment without informing the doctor. Without informing the doctor, he has left the treatment for some days, and after few days he is coming back, or few months he is coming back. I have taken the treatment but not completed the treatment. I just run away and I am a defaulter. So that is defaulter, that he has taken a incomplete treatment in the past. So did not complete the course or took inadequate or irregular medicines. That is defaulter, number one. Number two, relapse. Relapse is the person who has taken the complete treatment. He was very sincere till the 6 months, 8 months. He has taken complete treatment. He was negative at the end. At the end of the treatment, he was TB negative. Sputum was negative. But after few months or few years, again now he become positive. So that is relapse. Relapse has occurred. So he's an unlucky person. Third is failure. Failure also taken the treatment for the 6 months or 8 months, whatever. He has taken complete treatment. But at the end of, till the end of the treatment, he is still positive. He has completed treatment, but till end, he is still sputum positive. So that is known as failure, that he has failed to respond cat one. So we will shift him to cat two. So there are three types of cat two, whether default or relapse or failure DRF. These three are cat two. So RNTCP guidelines are there. These are the latest RNTCP guidelines I'm telling you. Done. So cat one or cat two. First you decide your patient, whether, so ask him properly whether you are a defaulter, whether you are a failure, or whether you are a defaulter, failure, or what is the third thing? Relapse. So he is not a defaulter, not a failure, not a relapse, and he's a new patient, so he's cat one, and either of them he's cat two. So once you have decided whether he's cat one or cat two, then offer treatment to him. Just suppose my patient is cat one. He's a new patient and he has never taken dots before. So I will explain him, you have to take treatment for 6 months. Out of the 6 months, total 6 months, the first 2 months is your intensive phase, and next 4 months will be your continuation phase. So total will be the 6 months. In the first 2 months, in intensive phase, you have to come to the hospital daily. And in front of me, you have to take the treatment. I will give you tablet. In front of me, you have to swallow the tablet. That is directly observed under supervision. That is intensive phase. And I will give you four drugs. HRZE. You know HRZE. So isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol, not streptomycin. So HRZE combined karke, I will make one tablet, and you have to take that tablet in front of me. In front of me daily for 2 months, you have to come, except Sundays, Monday to Saturday, you have to come. In next 4 months, the continuation phase, you have to come every first day of the week, not the complete week, first day of the week. If it is Monday, every Monday. Every Monday you will come, take the first dose in front of me. Rest of the doses from Tuesday to Saturday, I will give you for home. Then on next Monday, you have to take the empty strip. Then I will give you next week. So for the next 4 weeks, that will be your treatment. I will give you only two drugs, H and R. Combining H and R, I will make one tablet, and you have to take daily one tablet. So HRZE and HR for the 2 months and for the 4 months, daily, daily, daily. That is under direct observation. And here it is only first dose is observed. So total 6 month treatment is there. Give me a thumbs up. Everyone, give me a thumbs up if you got it. Everyone, give me a thumbs up if you got it. Should I proceed? Just a second. So can you see the 2 months, the 4 months, total 6 months? 2 months is intensive phase. 4 months is continuation phase. Intensive phase, patient has to come to the hospital daily and it is under directly supervision. Continuation phase, patient has to come first day of the week, not daily. Only first dose is observed. Rest of the time is given for the home. And what is the treatment? Here it is given HRZE. Daily we give HRZE. Here we give only HR, not ZE. Give me a thumbs up. That is cat 1. That is treatment for cat 1. Coming on cat 2. If the patient is cat 2, you have to counsel patient. Your treatment will be for 8 months, not 6 months. It will be 8 months. Compare. It will be for 8 months. The first 3 months is intensive phase and next 5 months is continuation phase. So total 8 months treatment will be there. In the first 3 months also, we divide it into 2 months and 1 month, total 2 parts. So in intensive phase, again you have to come daily. So first 2 months I will give you for HRZE, combining HRZE, all of them are oral. I will make one tablet and S injection. injectable. So daily one tablet and one injection. I will give you in front of me. One tablet, one injection for the 2 months daily, 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 daily. For the next month, I will give you only tablet, HRZE, no injection. But again, you have to come daily and in front of me, you have to take the tablet. You have to take HRZE. For the next 5 months, I will give you only HRE. Not Z, not S. Only HRE. And only first dose has to be supervised and rest you can take your home. So that is the thing. Have you got it? Have you got it? Let me summarize again. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So first, there is a patient in front of you. See the approach. I'm a doctor. There's a patient in front of me. I'm sitting in my OPD. Patient is coming. Patient is saying, doctor, I'm having cough since last few weeks. Cough is not responding to antimicrobial. I'm having low grade fever every evening. I'm having weight loss also. And I'm having lymphadenopathy also. It is not that way classical ki charo cheeze, every patient will have all these four things. Some will have some will have some. But if you are having a strong suspicion the patient is having TB, ask the patient to give three sputum sample. Three sputum. You know, one is on spot, second day morning, third day morning. Out of the three, if one is positive, ask the patient to start DOTS. DOTS is free treatment for TB. It is free of cost. It is provided in all government hospitals, in all PSCs. That is free of cost. And it is under RNTCP program. DOTS is launched under RNTCP programs. But there are certain conditions which are there launched by the government. So here in DOTS, first decide whether your patient is CAT 1 or CAT 2. Whether your patient is category 1 patient or category 2. Category 1 is a new patient. Category 2 is a patient who has already treated in the past. Already treated in the past, he can be defaulter, he can be failure, he can be relapse. There can be three conditions. All of them are considered in CAT 2. Now, if he is CAT 1, ask him your treatment will be 6 months, 2 months plus 4 months. 2 months will be intensive phase, 4 months will be continuation phase. And here in CAT 2, ask the patient your treatment will be 8 months. It will be 8 months, 3 months plus 5 months. 3 months will be again, I will divide 3 months into 2 months and 1 month and 5 months. So 3 months will be intensive phase, 5 months will be continuation phase. This is how we will treat the patient. So here in CAT 1, for intensive phase, you have to come daily in the hospital and I will give you one tablet containing four drugs HRZE. I will give you four drugs. And in continuation phase, you have to come only first day of the week and I will give you only two tablets, that is HR. Not ZND, that is HR. Give me a thumbs up. Here for 8 months, for the 3 months, intensive phase, for the first 2 months, I will give you one tablet containing HRZE and one injection, that is S. S is injectable. So daily I have to give one injection for the 2 months. For the next 1 month, I will give you only HRZE, no injection. And for the next 5 months, only first day you have to come to the hospital, not daily. And I will give you one tablet containing HRE. Everyone give me a thumbs up. I really tried hard. That is the regimen of the DOT. This is the latest regimen of the DOT. So category 1, category 2. Intensive phase, continuation phase. Total treatment here is 6 months. Total treatment here is 8 months. Now there is a rule. Whenever you are giving the treatment, you are starting from intensive phase. At the end of this intensive phase, at the end, do a sputum again. It is a rule, at the end of the intensive phase, the patient should be sputum negative. Continuation phase is for remission. So a patient should be non-infective at the end of the intensive phase. So here and here, you will do a sputum test again and patient should be negative. Then only patient can enter in continuation phase. If sputum of the patient is not negative yet, you have to increase the intensive phase for one more month. Then again do the sputum. Maximum patient will be negative till then transmit them to the continuation phase. Otherwise, you cannot transmit them to the continuation phase. Have you got it? Now, the worst to worst scenario, if the patient is CAT 1, imagine a patient is CAT 1. He's a new patient. So I have explained the treatment. The patient is convinced, okay, doctor, start the treatment. I will stick on the treatment, follow the treatment. So I will start from the 2 month intensive phase. At the end of the intensive phase, I have done a sputum. Patient was still positive. If it is the patient is negative, conventionally he will go on the continuation phase. But if the patient is positive, I will extend the intensive phase for one more month. And then again, I will do the sputum. The second time, if he is positive, again, I will shift him to CAT 2. So that is known as failure. He is not responding. He is a failure. He is not responding. Have you got it? And in CAT 2, if the patient is not responding, even after 1 month, he is positive after intensive phase, I will consider it has MDR, multi-drug resistant TB, and I will give him another treatment. Have you got it? So have you understood this point also? Have you understood this point? So that is the complete treatment. Have you got it? So that is the treatment. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Okay, I have told you in intensive phase, in continuation phase, you have to give what drugs? So if it is CAT1, you have to give HRZE followed by HR for 2 months, for 4 months. That is the thing, total 6 months. In CAT2, you have to first give HRZES for the 2 months, then HRZE for 1 month. This is 3 months, followed by HRE for the next 5 months. So what is the dose of HRZES, all of them, dose, how much milligram you will give? What is the dose? You got the regimen, but what is the dose? What is the dose? Dose depends on the weight of the patient. So weigh your patient. You should have a weighing machine at your OPD. Weigh the patient, and this is the dose. This is the dose. So how much HRZES, that is daily dose. Daily, how much you have to give? So this is the thing you have to see. You have to give 5 milligram per kg. If the patient is 60, in India we consider ideally the patient is 60 kg. So 5 into 60 will be 300. So either learn milligram per kg or learn 60 kg ke hisab se. Dono mein se ek cheez learn karo. So I suggest you to learn this table. So milligram per kg. So H is 5 milligram per kg. Patient is 60 kg. So 5 into 60, that will be 300. Whatever is weight your patient, multiply it. Multiplied. R is 10 milligram. If the patient is 60, so 60 into 10 is 600 milligram. If the pyrazinamide is 25, so 25 into 60 will be 1500. And E is 15. That is 15 into 60 is 1000. Have you got it? So ideally, whatever is the weight of your patient, in India, we consider it as 60 kg. Ideal weight of the patient should be 60 kg. So that's why these are the doses. But don't learn this. I guess to learn this is better. So 5, 10, 25, 15. So HRZE, 5, 10, 25, 15 milligram per kg. Aaya kya samajh mein? Have you got it? Again, give me a thumbs up. So it is 5 milligram per kg, 10 milligram per kg, 25 milligram per kg, 15 milligram per kg. And what about S? S is injectable. It is aminoglycoside. It is injectable. It is not oral. So I'm not giving you oral doses for S. Everyone give me a thumbs up again. So these are the doses. Many MCQs come for doses also. Have you got it? Have you got it? Now see the regimen again. This is the dots. This is the regimen of the dots. CAT1, CAT2. Many patients say us, we can't come to the hospital daily. So you are asking whether the patient is CAT1 or CAT2 during the intensive phase, continuation phase. Intensive phase, continuation phase. So you ask the patient to come to the hospital daily during intensive phase. Now, most of the patient denies, no, we can't come. It is very far from our home and we have work. We can't come daily. So offer some other treatment. So second choice, you prefer daily treatment. Always prefer daily. But if patient is unable to come daily, now give alternating. You won't give it for home. It is, you will not give the treatment for home. You ask the patient, okay, at max you can come alternating. At max, that, so we will offer treatment 3 days a week. Instead of 6 days a week, that is Monday to Saturday, we will offer you 3 days treatment a week. That is either TTS, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, or MWF. That is Monday, Wednesday, Friday. So you have to come every alternative. You have to come. No, skip in a koi treatment nahi, otherwise don't break the treatment, just die. That is your wish. So these are the only two treatments we offer. We prefer to give you daily treatment. But if you are not following, then at least alternate. At least alternate. So can you see? Can you see here? The treatment is same. You will give for the 2 months, you will give this thrice weekly. And for the next 4 months, you give this thrice weekly. Thrice weekly. We do not prefer it. But if we, if the patient is not ensured, then it is acceptable. If patient is not convincing, that. So here, in this case, if the patient is taking treatment, you will ask, ma'am, how it will work then? Instead of giving daily doses, we are giving 3 doses per week. Instead of 6 doses, we are giving only 3 doses every alternate day. So we increase the dose of each drug. We increase the dose of each drug. So isoniazid, instead of 5 milligram, we will give 10 milligram. Rifampicin, instead of 10, we will give 10 only. We are not increasing rifampicin, huh? Pyrazinamide 25 ka 35 ho jayega. Aur ethambutol 15 ka 30 ho jayega. Have you got it? So isoniazid, pyrazinamide aur ethambutol bad gaya. Ye 5 ka 10. 25 ka 35 or 15 ka 30. I tried hard. I tried out. Have you got it? So what is the treatment? HRZES. What is the dose? S is injectable. So leave it. HRZE, what is the doses? If the patient can take daily treatment, then the doses are 5, 10, 25, 15 milligram per kg daily dose. If the patient is coming to the hospital daily. If the patient is not coming daily, he is coming alternate day. That is 3 days a week. This is known as 3 days a week. If the patient is coming 3 days a week, PTS or MWF, then the 5 will become 10. 10 will remain 10 only. Rifampicin will not change. 25 will become 35 and 15 will become 30 milligram per kg. I really tried hard. So you should understand all these things for your MCQs. That is your dots. Have you got it? Now coming on drug resistance. If the patient is not getting cured even after CAT2 protocol. CAT1 se bhi he is not cured, CAT2 se bhi, so he is having drug resistance. So drug resistance is of two types. Very, very important. Multi-drug resistance, MDR, and extensive drug resistance, XDR. Have you got it? MDR and XDR. There are two types of drug resistance. Just a second. There are two types of drug resistance. Okay. Multi-drug resistance and extensive. What is the definition of each of them? Okay. Let me start with multi-drug resistance. What is multi-drug resistance? In multi-drug resistance, HRZES. Out of these five, patient is resistant for these drugs. For H and for R. With or without resistance with others. So with or without. So resistance can be there for other drugs also, cannot be there. But H and R definitely not working. So H is not working. R is not working. Rest of the drugs are working or not, it doesn't matter. That is the definition of MDR. Learn the definition of MDR. If such patient is in front of you, so you cannot offer conventional CAT1 and CAT2 protocol, because in CAT1 also, in CAT2 also, and H and R are the main drugs. Are the main drugs in intensive phase also, in continuation phase also. So we cannot offer that treatment. So for these patients, we have designed another DOTS. That DOTS is known as DOTS Plus. So DOTS Plus program is for treating the patient which are having MDR TB, multi-drug resistant TB ke liye. There is another program known as DOTS Plus. So what treatment you will offer them? Again, they have intensive phase, they have continuation phase. Intensive phase, continuation phase. Intensive phase lasts for 6 months, continuation phase lasts for 18 months. So 18 plus 6, 24 months. So the treatment is for 2 years. So remember, in CAT1, the treatment was for 6 months. That is 2 plus 4. Yes. In CAT2, the treatment was for 8 months. That is 3 plus 5. You know, 3 is in intensive phase and 5 in continuation phase. In MDR, treatment is for 24 months. Not 6, not 8. 24 months means 2 years the treatment chalega. Jisme ki the first 6 months is intensive. Patient has to come daily to the hospital in intensive phase. And next 18 months is continuation. So total 24. So it is 6 to 9. 24 months se bhi zyada ho sakta hai. 24 to 27 months. That is the treatment. Now what drugs you will offer? What drugs you will offer? You will offer 6 drugs in intensive phase and 4 drugs in continuation, total 10 drugs. You have to learn the name of the drugs. Now these drugs are not H and not R, because these patients are resistant for H and R. So you can offer other drugs. So in intensive phase, you will offer 6 drugs. That is kanamycin, Oflox, ethionamide. It is not ethambutol. It is ethionamide. Huh? Cycloserin, pyrazinamide and ethambutol. So ethambutol and pyrazinamide are there. HR is not there. Z and E is there. Z is there. E is there. And apart from Z and E, 4 other drugs are there. So kanamycin, Oflox, ethionamide and cycloserin. Have you got it? And in continuation phase, it is Oflox, ethionamide, cycloserin and ethambutol. So that you have to continue. And pyridoxin, that is vitamin B6, we give to prevent peripheral neuritis. Give me a thumbs up if you got it, everyone. So that is the treatment we offer for DOTS Plus. So in DOTS Plus, we offer 6 month plus 18 month, total 24 month treatment. In 6 month, that is intensive phase. The next 18 month is continuation phase. So in 6 months, we offer 6 drugs. So out of the 6 drugs, we cannot offer HR. We offer Z, we offer E. That is pyrazinamide, ethambutol, kanamycin, Oflox, cycloserin and ethionamide. So these are the 4 second line drugs. From first line, HRZES, we cannot give H, we cannot give R. And we do not give S because it is injectable. We give only Z and E. And these 4 drugs are from second line. Give me a thumbs up. In the 18 month treatment, we give these drugs only. So that is kanamycin, Oflox, cycloserin and ethambutol. So these are the four drugs. So total 10 drugs are given. Everyone give me a thumbs up and try it hard. That is DOTS plus. That is DOTS plus for MDR. Now coming on XDR. The other thing is, so most of these drugs, that is Oflox, Levoflox, Kanamycin and Cyclosurin and Ethionamide. These are second line drugs. First line drugs, we cannot give H to them. We cannot give R to them. So we can give Z and E to them. Have you got it? So along with Z and E, we are giving second line drugs in MDR TB. You know this classification, right? Coming on XDR, extensive drug resistant TB. Now this is the most deadly TB. Most deadly TB. Here, the patient is having resistance for H, for R, for one of the fluoroquinolones, that is floxacins. So floxacins. And for injectables also, that is aminoglycoside, that is capreomycin, kanamycin and amikacin, injectables. So out of this, patient have resistance, okay, I will mark for H, for R, for all fluoroquinolones, none of the floxacin is active from the second line. First line mein se do gaye, H nahi kaam karega, R nahi kaam karega. Second line mein se koi sa bhi floxacin kaam nahi karega, Oflox, Levoflox, Moxiflox, Ciproflox, fluoroquinolones are resistant. Koi sa bhi injectable kaam nahi karega, kanamycin, amikacin, capreomycin and streptomycin also. So very few drugs are remaining which are active. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. That is the definition. That is the definition of XDR. Have you got it? So you should know the difference between MDR and XDR. The definition of each of them. What is the difference between the two? So in MDR, patient have resistance for H and R from the first line. And none of the other drugs are resistant from the second line. In XDR, along with H, along with R, patient have resistance for fluoroquinolones also. That is all flox, Oflox, Levoflox, Moxiflox, Ciproflox, and all injectables. That is mycin, kanamycin, capreomycin, streptomycin, amikacin. That is aminoglycoside. So that is the resistance. Give me a thumbs up. Here, if the resistance in first line was for H and R, so we were offering these drugs here as a treatment. No? But here, we cannot offer these drugs also. So what we will offer as a treatment for XDR? So here, what we will offer for the treatment, we will offer some category 5 drugs which have some uncertain efficiency. So a panel, expert panel containing many doctors, they will decide the treatment. There is no fixed protocol. There is no fixed protocol for this XDR and the prognosis is very, very poor. Very poor. So we will give some other drugs of uncertain efficacy. Here, give me a thumbs up. I tried hard. Give me a thumbs up, everyone. Now, till now, I taught you. What is the treatment of CAT1? What is the treatment of CAT2? What is the treatment of MDR? What is the treatment for XDR? For XDR, there is no fixed protocol. Expert committee will decide from category 5 drugs, uncertain origin. And you know here in CAT1, CAT2 and MDR, in each of them, you know what is intensive phase, what is continuation phase. Give me a thumbs up. In CAT1, okay, let me write. It is HRZE and here only HR. It is for 4 months. It is for 2 months, it is for 4 months, total 6 months in CAT1. In CAT2, it is 2 months HRZES, 1 month HRZE and 5 months, it is HRE. So total 8 months, In MDR, it is Z and E, H and R is not effective. So Z, E along with Oflox, along with Levoflox, along with what were the other drugs? Capreomycin, Ethionamide. So you know the drugs. In continuation phase, also 4 drugs were there. So here it is for 6 months, it is for 18 months, total 24 months. And here there is no fixed protocol. So make this table with me. I tried hard for you people. You should make this table with me. Now I'm coming on the next category. If pregnancy may tuberculosis ho jaye, what drugs you will offer? If a pregnant female having pregnancy, she conceived and she is diagnosed with tuberculosis. She is coming to you saying, doctor, I am having pregnancy. I am having cough also. You have done a sputum. She is positive for TB and she is pregnant also. Now, you can't ask the patient to do the abortion. And what drug you will offer which is safe for the fetus, which is not teratogenic and the tuberculosis in that lady is also cured. So, you can offer HRZE. You cannot offer S. S is contraindicated in pregnancy. You know S is an aminoglycoside. It is streptomycin. It is aminoglycoside. It is contraindicated in pregnancy. If you give streptomycin to a pregnant lady, the fetus will be deaf by birth. By birth, congenital deafness will be there. It is autotoxic. Done. So you cannot offer S to a pregnant lady. So you will offer the treatment same as that of CAT1. In cat 1, there was no S. Total 6-month treatment. The first 2 months are intensive, containing HRZE. The next 2 months are continuation containing only HR. Give me a thumbs up. So treatment in pregnancy is same as that of cat 1. And S is contraindicated. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So pregnancy is also done. Coming on breastfeeding. If a female is breastfeeding and she become tubercular positive, what you will offer? You will offer the full course depending whether she is cat 1 or cat 2. Whatever she is, just test the female and give the complete treatment. All anti-tubercular drugs are compatible. Give complete treatment. Now, don't ask the female to stop breastfeeding. She should continue breastfeeding. Breastfeeding continue karegi. She will continue. So, it is possible via breastfeeding, the fetus, not via breastfeeding, the fetus is in close contact with the mother. No? So, fetus also get, not fetus, the infant. The infant is doing the breastfeeding of the mother. So, infant also become tubercular positive, tuberculosis positive. So, you want to give prevention to the infant also. So, you ask the lady to give BCG vaccine. BCG vaccine, the normally all infants get now at day one of birth. The neonate get BCG vaccine. So, BCG vaccine for the infant, for the neonate, and for the next 6 months, the mother is taking her treatment, either cat 1 or cat 2. Infant should be given only isoniazid. The infant should be given only isoniazid for prevention. We are giving treatment to the mother and we are giving prevention to the infant. To the mother, what we will offer? If she is cat 1, we will offer cat 1 treatment. If she is cat 2, we will offer cat 2 treatment. For prevention to the infant, we will offer two things. Number 1, BCG vaccine. And number 2, isoniazid for the 6 month. For the 6 month, we will offer only isoniazid. So for prevention, we will give isoniazid prevention treatment after ruling out active TB. Give me a thumbs up. That is for breastfeeding. That is for. So we are done pregnancy. We are done breastfeeding. We are done MDR. We are done XDR. We are done cat 1. We are done cat 2. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up. Next is chemoprophylaxis. What do you mean by chemoprophylaxis? If someone in the family is having tuberculosis, just suppose a kid, one of the patient, one of my colleague is there and her kid is having tuberculosis positive. Now, she cannot leave the kid for isolation. The kid cannot take care of himself or herself. So, mother has to come in close contact with the kid for giving medicine, for taking care of the kid. So, mother can become positive. No? Mother can become positive. So, we have to give prophylaxis to the mother. It is an example. Some parent, old person is becoming, some child is becoming tuberculosis positive. So, the caretaker is having a high risk of having to conceiving the contracting the tuberculosis infection from that patient. So, we will offer chemoprophylaxis to the caretaker. Done. So, again, we will give only isoniazid here. So, that is contact of the open cases who show recent Montex positive. Children with positive Montex. Neonate of the tubercular mother. Mother is having tubercular and we are giving prophylaxis to the neonate. So, we offer only isoniazid. How much? It is 10 milligram per kg. In children for the 6 months, as I have told you, it is 10 milligram. You have to learn also. Last thing, in the entire treatment, what I have taught you till now, what is cat 1 treatment, you know it. What is cat 2 treatment, you know it. What is MDR treatment, you know it. What is XDR treatment, you know it. What is treatment of tuberculosis in pregnancy? What is the treatment of tuberculosis in breastfeeding? What is the treatment of tuberculosis in the form of not treatment? Prevention, that is chemoprophylaxis of tuberculosis. So till now you know all, but none of these contain steroids as a part of treatment. Nowhere I have told you steroids. So does we give steroid as a tubercular treatment? Does we give? My question to you, does we give? Yes, we give very rarely sometimes. So what are the conditions when we offer steroid as a treatment, as a part of treatment? When the patient is having seriously ill TB, it is miliary TB. You know what is miliary TB? Of all the body, all organs having tuberculosis. Or severe pulmonary TB, then only we will give steroid. If there is hypersensitivity to ATT, anti-tubercular treatment, that is DOTS treatment, patient is having allergy or hypersensitivity, then we will offer steroids for immunosuppression. In AIDS patient, we will offer steroids. In meningeal TB, renal TB, pleural TB or pericardial TB. So four organs, meningeal means brain may meninges, renal, pleural, lung, not pulmonary, it is pleural and pericardial. So pleura and pericardia, you know. So these tuberculosis treatment, you will offer steroid also. So which steroid? Otherwise, steroids are contraindicated, especially in GIT TB. Idiosyncratic TB, GIT TB, you don't offer steroid there. Done. In meningeal TB, you offer dextromethorphan in the form of the steroid. In all other conditions, you offer prednisolone. So both of them are steroids. So where to give steroids? So these are the conditions. where not to give steroid. These are the conditions and which steroids are given. These are the name of the steroids. So MCQ can come on everything. This is the summary. The summary is in front of you. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Just give me 1 second so I can see your chat. So Abri Tojoit is asking, what do you do if CAT1 failure in pregnant female? So we will shift it on CAT2. But in CAT2, there is streptomycin. Now we will not give streptomycin. Apart from streptomycin, we will give the rest of the treatment. But we will not give streptomycin to pregnant lady in CAT2 also. What is the next question? Doesn't neonate H same 5 milligram per kg? No, neonate it is 10 milligram per kg. Done. Karthik Raj, have you got your answer? Anyone else having any other question? Please ask it without any hesitancy. If you have any doubt, that is the summary till now. So you know the treatment of CAT1. Yes, you know. You know the treatment of CAT1. This is the treatment of CAT1. See, CAT1. 2 months plus 4 months. 2 month HRZD and 4 month HR. What is the treatment of CAT2? CAT2 total 8 months treatment. This was 6 months. This is 8 months. The first 2 months contain all 5 drugs, HRZDs. The next 1 month, remove S, only HRZD. The next 5 months, remove Z also, only HRE. So you know. So that is CAT1 and CAT2. And you know the meaning of them. CAT1 is a new patient and CAT2 is previously treated patient. Have you got it? Have you got it? What is the chemoprophylaxis? If it is a neonate, we give INH, that is isoniazid, for 6 months. In adult, we give isoniazid for 9 months. That is chemoprophylaxis. And we know the treatment of MDR. We know the treatment of XDR. I have already taught you. In pregnancy also, in breastfeeding also, I have already taught you the treatment. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So I can see your polls. You have to, I can see your chat. I will launch the questions in the form of the polls. Just give me 1 second. Just give me 1 second. Okay. So I will launch the questions in the form of the polls. You have to write your answer in the chat box. I can see the chat now clearly. Done. Okay. So this is the first question. Till now it is all about the dots. So we are done with the dots. Okay. So this is the first question in front of you. Isoniazid is not given in which condition? The 4 options are in front of you. So isoniazid, I'm asking about the side effect of isoniazid. So isoniazid is not given in renal disease or liver disease, that is hepatitis, that is diabetes or hypertension. In which of the following isoniazid is not given? Yes, most of you are right. Isoniazid is not given in liver disease, that is hepatitis, because the side effect of isoniazid is hepatitis. If the patient is already having hepatitis and if you give isoniazid, the hepatitis will exaggerate. So you cannot give isoniazid to a patient which is having hepatitis or liver disease. Yes. You all are right. So you should know the side effect profile of each of them, HRZDs. So at the starting of the lecture only, I have revised you. I have made you to revise the comparative table. So have you got it? Yes, you all are right. The correct answer is B. Very good. Very good. Very good. And okay, coming on the next question. If somebody develops resistance to isoniazid, patient will simultaneously develop resistance to which of the following drug? Along with isoniazid, what is the second drug which is having resistance in MDR? In MDR, I taught you there is resistance for 2 drugs. Which 2 drugs? Along with, one is isoniazid. What is the other drug? So these 2 drugs, that is H plus what, have simultaneous resistance always in MDR. Yes, most of you are right. Very good. So Khushi, Abel, Ayusha and Karthik, you all are right. The correct answer here is rifampicin. So H plus R. In MDR. In MDR, there is resistance for 2 drugs. That is isoniazid and rifampicin. So that is rifampicin is the correct answer here. Very good. Very good. This is the next question in front of you. Please read the question. ATT that kills slowly or intermittently dividing bacteria. I have told you this table very clearly that which of the following drug kills slow dividing, which of the following kills intermittent dividing, which of the following kills fast dividing, which of the following kills puta. So that you should know very clearly. So the options are isoniazid, rifampicin, paracinamide and streptomycin. Give your guess. What is your guess? I have told you this not in this lecture but in the last video I have clarified this thing. So you should watch the recording. Yes, you all are right. The correct answer here is B. It is rifampicin which kill slow or intermittent dividing. Fast dividing is killed by isoniazid and sputters are killed by paracinamide. So that you should know. That you should know. Okay, so let me skip this question. Yes. Which of the following anti-tubercular drug causes optic neuritis? Very specific question, specific answer. Specific question, specific answer. Optic neuritis, that is color blindness. Due to optic neuritis, patient have green vision. Green vision or color blindness. So very specific question. So which of the following ATT? Only one of them causes optic neuritis. Yes. So you all are right. The correct answer here is very good. It is ethambutol. So ethambutol causes optic neuritis. We know. You should know specific side effect of each of them. As I have discussed the side effect profile for each of them, you should know the specific side effect and common side effect in each of them. So, okay. So there are five drugs. HRZES. And if you ask the side effect profile, H, R and Z, they cause hepatitis. So hepatitis is common in the first three, and this is the severity of hepatitis. Most severe is caused by pyrazinamide. Second most severe is caused by rifampicin. Least severe hepatitis is caused by isoniazid. So hepatitis is common in each of them, in the first three. And hyperuricemia or gout is common in the fourth and the fifth. That is ethambutol and pyrazinamide. Hyperuricemia is common. Rest of them have specific side effects. So what is the specific side effect profile in each of them? H along with hepatitis have peripheral neuritis. So peripheral neuritis is specific. To prevent peripheral neuritis, we give pyridoxine or vitamin B6. Done. Rifampicin along with hepatitis, it is having flu-like symptoms and blood dyscrasia. And orange urine. Orange urine is very specific. For rifampicin, orange urine, orange tears, orange saliva, orange all secretions in the body. Pyrazinamide along with hyperuricemia and hepatitis, nothing special. Ethambutol along with hyperuricemia, optic neuritis special, which is nowhere else. Streptomycin, the mnemonic is ON, that is autotoxic, neurotoxic, nephrotoxic and teratogenic, HT. Hypersensitivity and teratogenic. It is teratogenic. So these are the side effect profile. You should always remember. Have you got it? So optic neuritis is caused by ethambutol. Have you got it? Okay. Which of the following anti-TB drug is not bactericidal? I'm asking not. Only one of them is not bactericidal. There are five drugs. HRZES. Only one is static. Bacteriostatic. Rest all are bactericidal. Tell me which of them. Yes, you all are right. Very good. It is an easy question. Very easy question. So only ethambutol is bacteriostatic. Rest all are bactericidal. Only ethambutol is bacteriostatic. Never forget. So the correct answer here is D. So this is how you have to learn. You have to learn this. So only ethambutol is bacteriostatic. Rest all are bactericidal. And if it is lung, okay, let me take next slide. This is lung. And inside the lung, these are the cells, alveolar cells in the lung. This is the bacteria. So some bacteria is present intracellular inside the lung cells. Some bacteria, mycobacterium tuberculosis, is present extracellular. Now, some of these drugs kill both intracellular and extracellular bacteria. Some of them kills only extracellular. Some of them kills only intracellular. So this is how you have to learn that also. Which of them is killing intracellular? Which of them is killing extracellular? Which of them is killing both? That you have to learn. That I have told you this also. Done. That you have to learn. Okay. Isoniazid dosage in infants. What is the isoniazid dosage in infants? What you will say? The four options are in front of you. What is isoniazid dosage? It is 5 mg per kg per oral. 5 to 15 mg per kg per oral. 300 mg BID or 300 mg once a week. What you will say? So the correct answer here is A. It is 5 mg per kg per oral. I am asking dosage for treatment, not for prevention. For prevention, it is 10 mg. For chemoprophylaxis, it is 10. But for treatment, it is 5 only. 5 mg. For infants also, for adults also, the dose of isoniazid is 5 mg per kg per oral. It is not injectable. It is oral. Have you got it? RNA transcription is blocked by which ATT? This question is based on mechanism of action. So RNA transcription is blocked by which ATT? So the four options are in front of you: rifampicin, chloramphenicol, streptomycin and isoniazid. Chloramphenicol is not at all an ATT. ATT is anti-tubercular treatment. Chloramphenicol is out of the question. Rest of the three, you should know mechanism of action of all of them. Yes, you all are right. Ayusha, you are absolutely right. The correct answer here is rifampicin. You should know mechanism of action of each of them. HRZES. Out of these five, three of them inhibit cell wall. Which three of them inhibit cell wall? H, Z and E. They inhibit cell wall synthesis. H inhibit FAST2 enzyme. That's why inhibit mycolic acid synthesis. Z inhibit FAST1 enzyme. again inhibits mycolic acid synthesis, and E inhibits arabinosyl galactose. So inhibit arabinosyl galactum enzyme formation in the cell wall. So these three inhibit cell wall synthesis. Rifampicin inhibit RNA synthesis by inhibiting an enzyme known as DNA dependent RNA polymerase. It is RNA polymerase, DNA dependent RNA polymerase. And streptomycin inhibit protein synthesis by inhibiting 30S and 50S of the ribosome and inhibiting the initiation in them. Have you got it? So the five things are there, which is inhibiting cell wall, which is inhibiting RNA, which is inhibiting protein. So that is the summary. It should be crystal clear to you. So RNA transcription is inhibited by rifampicin. Rifampicin. RNA ki jagah agar the protein inhibition hota, to answer is streptomycin. Yahan pe cell wall inhibition hota, to answer is isoniazid. Have you got it? Just a second. I'm really sorry. Next question in front of you. Please read the question. In patient on isoniazid, which vitamin deficiency is likely to have? Isoniazid. So the four options are in front of you. Yes, you all are right. The correct answer here is vitamin B6. It is vitamin B6 which is causing, which is deficient due to isoniazid. So that's why we always give pyridoxine, that is vitamin B6. Pyridoxine along with isoniazid as a part of prophylaxis. So that is a thing. That is a thing. Okay, you have to learn this also. Antitubercular drug which is having depression and suicidal tendency. So that I forgot to tell you in the last lecture, that you have to add in your notes. The answer is cyclosurin. So these are second line drugs. Cyclosurin, capreomycin, kanamycin. You should know side effect of these second line drugs also. So among them, cyclosurin is the drug which is having suicidal tendency. It causes severe depression. So you should know that also. ATT which is contraindicated in a pregnant female. Just now I taught you this. ATT which is contraindicated in pregnant female. Which ATT is not given in pregnancy? Only one among them. Yes, first. So is it isoniazid? Is it rifampicin? Is it streptomycin? Is it ethambutol? Yes, you all are right. It is streptomycin. Streptomycin. It is contraindicated in pregnancy because it is teratogenic, because it causes deafness in the fetus, congenital deafness in the fetus. The same question. Ototoxicity is caused by. So it is caused by streptomycin. So the correct answer here is B. You all know it. ATD causing hyperuricemia. I have told you, out of the five drugs, two causes hyperuricemia or gout. Which two causes hyperuricemia or gout? Who will tell me? Who will tell me first? The first three drugs causes hepatitis. The third and the fourth causes hyperuricemia. So hyperuricemia or gout is caused by pyrazinamide and ethambutol. So among the option, you find only pyrazinamide. Ethambutol is not there in the option. If ethambutol is there in the option, it is also correct. So the correct answer among them is B. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up. The correct answer among them is B. Patients suffering from MDR are can be treated with all of the following drugs except, so which is not included in MDR. I have taught you the treatment for MDR also. So which is not included in MDR treatment. Okay. So the answer of this question is not there. It is a controversial. Okay, let it be. Last thing, that was the treatment of tuberculosis. Coming on prophylaxis. For prophylaxis, there is a vaccine known as BCG vaccine. We know BCG vaccine. What is the full form of BCG? Very few of you know the full form of BCG. It is Bacille Camiti Guerin. That is the name of the scientist who has developed this vaccine. So how this vaccine is developed? What is this vaccine? How it is developed? Now we know tuberculosis is caused by a bacteria. The name of the bacteria is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Now there is another bacteria which is known as Mycobacterium bovis. So instead of for developing vaccine, we do not use Mycobacterium tuberculosis. We use Mycobacterium bovis. So what actually we do, we take a culture plate. This is the agar plate, culture plate, not agar plate. It is, culture media, specific culture media for the tuberculosis. We grow Mycobacterium bovis on this culture media. And after growing, we do the subculture. How many times we do the subculture? We are doing subculture for 239 times. In which media we are taking? The specific media is LG media. So we are taking LG media. In LG media, we are growing this mycobacterium bovis inside it, mycobacterium bovis colonies are formed, and we are doing 239 times subculture from this plate to another plate, another plate, another plate. For doing so for 239 times, it requires 13 years, because on each culture plate it requires 6 to 8 weeks for 2 months. So on one plate it requires 2 months. So for 239 times it requires 13 years. So after that, its pathogenicity decreases, it become attenuated. For multiple subculturing, it become attenuated. So we found a avirulent strain. So that the name of that strain is Bacillus chymatiguirum. It is developed from Mycobacterium bovis, not from Mycobacterium tuberculosis. It requires 13 years for doing 239 subcultures on LG media. Have you got it? The name of the strain is Danish 1331 strain. That is the avirulent strain of Mycobacterium bovis. It is attenuated. It is avirulent. And the strain is available in BCG laboratory, Guindy, Chennai. Have you got it? You have to learn all this information. So BCG vaccine available in the market in this form. Can you see? So the vaccine is available in the form of powder. Along with it, that is the solvent. So when you have to use the vaccine, you have to dissolve this powder in this solvent. But you have to do the reconstitution, and after doing reconstitution, you have to give the injection. Intradermal injection you have to give. So at the time of giving injection, you have to do this reconstitution. What is this liquid? This solvent. What is this liquid? This is solvent. This is normal saline, NaCl. So this is NaCl. Can you see? This is written here also. It is sodium chloride. It is Na. If you read it, NaCl, it is normal saline. Solvent here is always normal saline. It is not distilled water like measles. In measles also, it comes in powder form, but there distilled water is the solvent. Here NaCl is the solvent. That you have to learn for your MCQs. Once you have reconstituted, you have to use it within 3 hours. So once you have dissolved the powder here, you have to use within 3 hours. If you can't use within 3 hours, discard it. It is ineffective, discard it. Have you got it? What is the dose? 0.1 ml. For giving 0.1 ml dose, there is a different syringe. Can you see? So this along with the syringe. For filling 0.1 ml, the name of the syringe here is tuberculin syringe. It is Omega microstate syringe. It is 26 gauze syringe. You know, 26, very thin, 26 gauze syringe. So that is 0.1 ml. So 0.1 ml contains 0.1 milligram. 0.1 ml contains 0.1 milligram. What is the route? Intradermal. It is given intradermal. You know, intradermal. It is not subcutaneous. It is intradermal. It is always given in left deltoid muscle. Can you see? Left deltoid here. Can you see? It is given in the left side. It is the left side of this child. So left deltoid by convention. So if you see on your left deltoid, you will find a mark. I am having a mark. You may also have it. If your parents have given you BCG on your day one. So it is given in the skin. On the left deltoid by convention. Give me a thumbs up. What is the age at which it is given? It is given at day one. In National Immunization Schedule, NIS, it is given at day one. This is the National Immunization Schedule. You can see BCG at birth at day one. And none of the booster is there. Rest of the vaccine, you already know when DPT is given, when OPV is given, when HAP1, when influenza virus is given. So these are the vaccines that you have to learn NIS in your PSM. Done. So phenomenon after vaccine, at 2 to 3 weeks, papule is formed, then papule will increase, it will break, ulcer is formed, pustule is formed, and then ultimately a scar is formed. Can you see here? Papule is formed. So that is the whole history, and at the end, scar is formed. Protective efficacy is 80%, protective duration is 20 years. I'm done. Thank you very much. So I have to stop here. You have to give me 1 minute. So let me announce my next lecture. Okay, here only I can announce. So my next lecture is after 5 minutes. After 5 minutes at 11:30 sharp, I'm having next lecture. Where? Not on YouTube. I'm having a free class only, but not on YouTube. I'm having a free special class on Unacademy platform. So those who are the newcomers, please install Unacademy Learners app from the Play Store. Apply code SACHDEV10 and watch my free class. What I am teaching, I am going to teach hematology. In pathology, I am teaching you hematology. I am teaching you lymphomas. Don't dare to miss it. I am teaching you all lymphomas together. So I am coming back. You have to join the link, install the app, click on the link, use code SACHDEV10. That is my surname. Again, I am saying use code Sachdevan. So I am ending the stream and you just click on the next link for watching my next lecture. See you. Bye-bye.